honored if you would join us.
Each team will have its own set of defensive core principles. These are the defensive principles that I coach my team on, and I'm a firm believer in. I see these principles laid out in teams like the Crusaders. I see them laid out in teams like Leinster. Some of the higher class teams in the world, I see this while I watch them. And so let's go over these. And as we get further into the video, we'll break down each individual principle. Our first principle is eyes up, communication and nomination, spacing, connection in threes, line speed, and ultimately what we want is all of this will lead to somehow the regaining of possession. Our first defensive principle is eyes up. What we want when we talk about our eyes up is we want our exterior defenders being able to look up and solely focus on the attacking players that are directly in front of them. What often comes into question with this is how do these exterior defenders, how do they know when the ball is out? So how do they know when to advance? That responsibility will often lie on these players here on the fringe of the ruck. That is, you know, either our pillar one and pillar two. Some coaches call them A and B, whatever you'd like to call them. But if these players here that are on the fringe of the ruck, if they are able to communicate to the players on the exterior of the defense, they're able to communicate when ball is out. What that does is it allows for our players out here, it allows them to identify which attacking players they are going to be marking. And if there's any, you know, switches or any lines or loops or things like that that the attacking players run, they're able to more effectively and efficiently communicate between themselves. Instead of having to look back at the ruck and then look at the attacking players, they can just solely focus on the attacking players that are directly in front of them. And nominate who has which player. Our next defensive principle is communication and nomination. So if our interior players, if our interior defenders are focused around what's going on around the ruck and they're able to call ball out, what we can do is we can have our exterior defenders communicating with one another, with their person on the inside, person on the outside, specifically who they're guarding, so that there's no confusion between number seven pinching in here, right? There's no confusion about him pinching in here and then them both double teaming number 10, leaving a large hole for number 12 to run right through. What we do want is we want our defenders spreading out and then we want them nominating and saying, you know, hey, I've got number 10, I've got number 10. Number seven saying, hey, I've got number 12, I've got number 12. Number 13 saying, I've got number 13, I've got number 13. That is what we want to see. And so very often that comes in the form of, hey, I've got blue socks. I've got blue socks. Hey, I've got red cleats. Hey, I've got red cleats. Often it comes in that form. But what is important is that everyone understands exactly who is guarding who and what we are doing. And so as long as that communication and that nomination happens, it's much, much more difficult for the attacking team to break through the defensive line. Spacing is another crucial aspect and principle of our defense.
I got it!
Really what spacing comes down to is identifying and communicating and nominating with the people around you what the attacking team is presenting you at this very moment and how you can best stop their attack. And so if you want to look at kind of like hard numbers, what we typically look at around the fringe of our ruck is there's typically two players that are almost always designated to guarding the ruck. And so typically what we want is we want about 2 meters or 3 meters of space in between those players. Then once you get to the back line, that 2 or 3 meters opens up to about 5 or 6 meters, depending on the picture that the attacking team is presenting you.
It's not wise to upset a Wookiee.
I'm a Wario. I'm gonna win.
If you notice here on attack, we've got two loose forwards out wide. Not much going on in the 12 channel. There's no attacking threat on the inside of the 10 either. Yet, what we do have here is we have four players that are bunched up right here around the ruck. And so defensively, what we're looking to do is we want to nullify that attack wide, but we have all these players bunched up around here. And so how do we get those players out wide, or how do we get our team, how do we get our players out wide as quickly and as efficiently as possible? So there are a couple of theories about this that some coaches prefer one thing, some coaches prefer the other. I will tell you what I prefer personally is everyone's got to be able to ruck and everyone's got to be able to tackle on your team at all times. That is my opinion. Wings ruck, tens tackle, everyone does everything. And so what I want here is I want number 8 and number 6, I want them pushing everybody else out. So our call is push. And so what that looks like is this. So if you've noticed, our 6 and our 8, they've pushed out, they have appropriate spacing, and then you also have number 10 who's pushed out as well. And so for me personally as a coach, it's not just number 10 guards number 10, it's not just, you know, number 6 guards number 6, it's not 13 on 13, it's everyone needs to be able to defend every player. And so we can't always have, on defense or attack, you can't always have a mapped out plan. This is rugby, things happen, it's not football. And so what we need to be able to do is we need to be able to think on our feet and defend appropriately regardless. What we have here is we've got our two players, or our two groups kind of on either side of the ruck. You know, we can just call them A and B. We've got A and B that are 2 to 3 meters apart, and then we've also got our 5 meter breaks now. There's no attacking threat on the inside, so we can communicate and nominate with our eyes up, identifying who the attacking team is bringing towards us and where specifically they're looking to attack. Connection in threes. Defensively, we always want to be working in groups of three. And so this is a great example. I've just kind of broken it down here. So let's go over it right now. So say number 12 has got the ball, and number 12 is going to attack on the outside shoulder of the defensive 12 of our 12, and on the inside shoulder of the 13. So he's trying to come and he's trying to attack in this channel. Yahoo! Right here. What that's going to look like is that's number 12's man, right? And so we don't want number 13 coming in. We don't want that, all right? Because if he does come in, what that means is that number 12, and this is what number 12 is trying to do here, the attacking 12, he's trying to draw in two defenders at once. And so if he can do that, that means that there's going to be a gap out wide and we'll be a man down out wide. What we do want to happen is we want number 12 to make his tackle, right? And so once that tackle is made, it's actually going to be number 6's job, the inside man of the tackler. It's going to be his job to make a decision. So let's talk about what that decision looks like right now. So here's our ruck. The attacking number 12 just took it into our player who made the tackle. Number 6 is coming around from the inside, and this is where his decision needs to be made. If we're going to challenge this ruck, if we're going to counter ruck, if we're going to go for a poach, we want that poach or we want that counter ruck coming from a player that's on the inside, okay? If we do that, then we still have, hopefully, we still have quality numbers out wide, same way. But if we come from the inside, okay, if we do come from the inside, that's okay, because number 6 is coming around regardless. And so this is his decision that he has to make. He's got to make the decision. Is he going to come around the corner of this ruck? Is he going to fill this role right here? Or is he going to come in to try and poach this ruck and try and take that ball? And so that is the decision that we need number 6 to work with, and we need him to make, essentially. It's a split-second decision. Probably happens in a tenth of a second. But that tenth of a second is so, so important. If... worst case scenario here is if number 13 is actually the one that comes in and and rucks and tries to counter ruck, and he gets in the ruck, we are exposed out wide. And all what that means is, if we don't get this ruck, we're down a man out wide. Almost, we're almost down two men, because number six, if number 13 is in this ruck, number six is either going to have to go around the ruck and around number 13 and cover all this space out here, or he's going to have to double down and he's going to have to join this counter ruck as well, which gets really messy. So this is just an example about how we always want to stay connected in our threes, and we want to work together from inside out in our threes. And if we're going to jackal, or we're going to counter ruck, or we're going to go for that poach, that's all going to come from the inside man. Line speed. Line speed is crucial to any team's defensive success. What's not crucial is that we play a specific kind of defense that has a specific kind of line speed. As long as everyone understands what is going on and what the game plan is, then most things can be executed relatively well if it's a sound game plan, right? So if we take a look at the example right here, this is just our example for right now, for line speed. Defensively, we've got our A and our B. We've got our 10, 7, 12, and our wing, which is dropped back, preparing for a kick. On attack, what they have is they've got their 10, they've got two centers, they've got a loose forward, and they've got a wing. So depending on how far our wing is dropped, really what they have is they've got a 5-on-3 for a little while. And so our defensive set, or our line speed, is going to look a specific way to try and cope with that. So what we have here is, and what we would do here, what most teams would do, is they would do what's called surf defense, surf D, or some people call it a slide D or a soft D. Really what it is we want to create a banana shape. And so what we'll do is we'll make our call, and then our players will react accordingly. And so let's talk about what that will look like right now. So as you can see here, what the attacking team has done, they've gotten the ball out to their inside center, their 12, and we are in our surf D. Some teams call it a slide D. I really don't like that term, slide D, because that implies that you don't need to come up on defense. Even when we're in our surf D or our soft D, we do still want to create that banana shape. And so that kind of looks like that, right? And so as the ball moves out, we will be able to use the extra defender, which is the touchline. Touchline is always an extra defender. We want to force them to our extra defender being the touchline, right? And so if we create this arch, eventually as the ball moves further out wide, we'll be able to, in a controlled manner, we'll be able to give up meters, but we'll be able to secure that tackle. So it's essentially saying, we know that we're going to give up meters, we know that you're going to gain space, but we're going to try and control what that is. And so instead of risking it and possibly giving up 20 or 30 or 40 or more meters, we're going to say, hey, we know we're going to give up 10 meters. We're going to control the fact that you're going to gain 10 meters. We're going to make our tackle, and then we're going to reset. We're going to live to see another day. And so that's what a lot of teams like to do in our line speed. This is just an example. This is just our surf D, where we want to create that banana shape and control the amount of space that the attacking team gains. Ultimately, teams don't need line speed. What they need is communication and understanding and the ability to execute the line speed that is needed at that moment. Another example of line speed is what's called a blitz defense. And so what you're trying to do in a blitz defense is you are trying to take or claim all the space in between your defensive line and the attacking line that the opposition have formed. And so a great way of explaining this to your players is when the ball's on the ruck and the nine's got the ball, what you want to do is you want to race. As a defensive player, you are racing the ball. And you want to race the ball from the nine to the 10. And you want to be at the 10's depth by the time that the ball gets to number 10. And so from that, you can obviously apply a lot of pressure. And so we're going to just talk very briefly about an outside in defense and what that can look like. So this is going to be our hunt defense. And so this is when we want to close the door. A lot of teams will operate like this in the red zone when the opposition are on the 10-meter line, the 20-meter line, and they're bearing down and they're trying to score. And so essentially what you're doing, if you notice, is you're leaving the last man open. And so you are susceptible at times. You are susceptible to a kick from this defensive formation, essentially. And so what you want to happen is whoever's marking the 10, as soon as the ball leaves the 9, this man is shooting all the way up at the 10. And so the concept is to apply as much pressure as possible. This man, and there are typically, you know, probably one or two men on either side of him. This man is coming up strong, probably 7 meters or so. He's creating a foundation for a defensive line. And then on the outside, the exterior, what you're trying to do in hunt is you are trying to close the door. So you don't want the ball to even be able to get to the last attacking player. And so these guys, these last two guys, they're specifically marking the second to last man in the attacking line and the third to last man in the attacking line. So what they're trying to do is they're going 12 or 15 meters deep into the attacking space, and they're claiming that space. And so they are shooting well out of the line while also watching what decisions the 10 and the 12 make and being able to read those decisions. What these guys want to do is as soon as one of their players catches the ball, they want to be able to make contact with them. And so they want to meet the attacking player the same time that the attacking player catches the ball. Ultimately, everything we have discussed today is for the purpose of regaining possession. You want to play footy with the ball in your hand, or you want to put the opposition in their own 22 and put some pressure on them defensively. Regardless, you've got to have these traits that we discussed today. This has been our discussion about defense and its core principles. If there are other principles you coach or another area of the game you would like me to cover, feel free to leave a comment below.
You know, sometimes I amaze even myself.
Hey, you're very good! See you next time!